Welcome in, YouTube family. You guys have been demanding it, so we shall supply it. We're gonna go over some TIG welding techniques, when and where you should be dipping your wire versus lay wire. Let's get into it. Dip, dive, dodge, dab, and dip, or lay wire. What do you do when you TIG weld? Really, what I think it boils down to is kind of preference. However, there are some pros and cons to both. So today we've got the setup. We got the Lincoln Sprinter 180SI hooked up to that 100% argon at about 25 CFH. Believe it or not, this is a 200 amp machine. Even though it says 180, it will go up to 200 amps. It has the high frequency, it has the pulse, which we're not gonna touch today, but we will have that foot pedal to really control our puddle. What we're going to end up welding on is this bottle box. If you've been following the channel, I'm trying to put together a fabrication trailer, and of course it needs to hold some gas. So this is going to be the bottle box. It's nothing but tin gauge and channel iron and some square tubing, and it's all cleaned up, tacked up, ready to weld. We've got some different fits on here, and we're going to go about structurally welding with TIG with different size wires, because that does matter when it comes to trying to lay wire, dip, dunk. That's what we're gonna go over today. I also got my Lincoln 3350 Advanced Series welding hood. I love this type of hood for welding TIG because of all the extra sensors in it. Really picks up these different angles and all the stuff that might be blocking stuff. It always has a sensor to catch it. Got our TIG torch ready. I think everything is set up. Like I said, we're gonna go over some different wires. We'll go into the dry run now and kind of give you a close up of what kind of techniques I'm gonna be using. We'll probably start here on this outside corner joint of the bottle box. What we're gonna be going over again today is the challenge of either pushing and feeding filler metal into each movement, or just simply laying that filler metal in where it needs to be and welding over it. I do again believe that this has got a little bit to do with personal preference, but also whatever weld you're trying to achieve. As you pull your filler metal out, you're probably gonna see that your puddle will sink and you'll get deeper penetration as you pull away and keep your filler out of your puddle. What is the one saying that I say all the time these days? I heard it first from Adam Stretch, and that is your filler is your chiller. So as you introduce your filler metal to your puddle, it's soaking up some of that amperage, soaking up some of that heat. So instead of pulling it out, you keep that filler in. You can imagine you may not get the depth of penetration you're looking for. However, it might be what you need if there's a bigger gap, or maybe you just turn your amperage up hot enough that it still sinks in. All these things to consider when doing this technique: what metal you're welding on, the thickness that you have, what wire thickness do you have. Today we're going to go over a couple of examples using 1/8, 3/32, and 16th inch wire as we do the dab and the dip technique. Now we're going to start with a 3/32 TIG wire. This is probably the wire that I would choose to weld something this thickness. And we're going to do a dip on this side, and we'll do a lay wire on the other. Now my machine's set fairly high. I won't use all that amperage. Trying to get set up properly. Probably only get a couple inches before I resituate. When you go to about dipping that wire, it's not necessarily a drag the whole time. You try to find that right amperage, and then you occasionally let that filler metal come in, chill out your puddle. This filler metal has a lot of good stuff in it as far as deoxidizers, especially on carbon steel. The 70S6 makes a nice clean weld with all the good alloys that's in the wire. But I'm thinking this 3/32 is just a hair big now that I've got some dipping on it. Not the prettiest looking weld either. But nonetheless, that filler is coming in and chilling out that filler, that puddle, as you come across your weld. Whereas that lay wire, you might see a little bit more of a, well, I'll call like a slug as you lay it across. We'll see that one next. All right, now this side, we're gonna just lay that wire in. Now again, the reason why it gets the name lay wire is because we simply just lay that wire in typically whatever joint configuration there is. I will say that it's not always just something you can just lay in there unless there's just a nice fit up where it just seems to wanna settle there. I wouldn't get too comfortable, as if you try to put too much pressure in one spot, that wire will want to run some other direction. Just keeping on it, and I'm able to move a little bit quicker, having a hard time staying steady on this joint. But I'm definitely feeling like I'm having to be a little bit less accurate. It's a little easier to make this weld with the lay wire, not having to pay attention to that dipping or dabbing or whatever. Especially if you're not looking for super aesthetically pleasing welds, that Laywire technique gets the job done just fine. As far as penetration, it looks like, if I had to guess, the dipping one definitely took a little bit more as far as penetration goes. And that's really what you're gonna see the difference between the two. That, and if you want a nice prettier bead with those stacked dimes, you're gonna have to dip that wire. Now, I'm not gonna lie, those didn't necessarily turn out the way I thought I was gonna weld those. I thought I was gonna leave something more impressive on there for you guys. But nonetheless, I did think that our amperage was a little high, which again, with the foot pedal, we have control over that. However, I'm gonna set it down so I have a little bit better control. So now we're at 100 amps and we're gonna move down to this 16th inch wire. And I'm really gonna take my time and try to make a good weld here, all while dipping. Again, the only thing I'm changing now is this amperage and the wire size. Not so much chiller. Now that I've got the lower amps, it should be okay to handle. Now, every time I dip, the goal is to feed into that dip. If you could provide some filler into each dip, you'll get a little bit of a better result. I am having a hard time right now trying to not burn up my fingers. Might just do it over the, be easier to go over the top now that I'm thinking about it. Let's try that. If you've seen me talk about TIG welding, body positioning, welding in general is key. So I made myself more comfortable. That's gonna help make it a little bit more easier to be more consistent. I'm gonna do this first half while dipping, and then I'll do the last half while lay wire. This smaller 16th inch wire is definitely working out a lot better as far as having control. And I've also turned down my amperage a little bit. Put my trusty little clamp here. That's just to have something else to sit on. So we'll start this first half of the weld with the dip technique. We're full pedal at the 100 amps. Every time I'm dipping, I wanna make sure I'm feeding into the actual fillet weld of this outside corner joint. I wanna fill it up. Looks like I got some crud in there and didn't clean it properly. Regardless, every time that I go to feed this wire, I'm taking a moment and pausing and feeding into that puddle. If you can kind of keep that rhythm of pause and feed, that'll help make your weld a lot more consistent. As soon as you move your torch head backwards one way or the other, your ripple pattern kind of changes a little bit. Now we're gonna move into the lay wire here. Again, just making sure that puddle stays connected. However, with the 16th inch wire, I've got to put a little bit of pressure to make sure it stays connected to that puddle. Kind of defeats the purpose if we let it come out. All I'm doing is just trying to keep that wire properly in the groove. Not only that, but you want to keep your wire in the same line as the weld joint. If you hold your wire lower or higher, then that wire is going to start to run away the direction that it's hanging. And essentially what I mean by that is you keep your filler in line with your weld. If you put your filler and you've got it trying to fill it in while your hand's lower than your weld, then that wire is going to run down towards your hand. If you have your wire up this way, that wire is going to want to run up towards your hand. If you have your wire in line with your weld, then the wire is going to run back towards your hand, which is again in line with your weld joint. That's the trick to keeping that lay wire smooth. Now, moving on to this next bit of weld is why you might want to consider maybe moving up in wire size, okay? And what I mean is, now that we've got to something thicker than just the 10 gauge, we've got some channel iron that's significantly thicker, we've got to turn up our welding machine first of all. Otherwise, we're going to be spending all day on this little tiny weld. Not only that, but we've got some kind of a bit of a significant gap. I could shove that 1/8 inch wire all the way through it. It's going to make it a lot easier to manage to lay wire those bigger gaps, or even just dip in this 1/8 inch wire onto this thicker metal. We could still use that 332, no problem. It honestly might be a better option for that, but for the gap, I'm gonna use this 1/8 inch. We're at 170 amps. I've got a tiny little gap here, but not too anything big to worry about. And this is where I was telling you where you can have enough amperage and still lay wire something to get the job done. Just wait and let that weld soak. You wanna see it sink. You've got enough metal there that it's not gonna pop through or melt through. You just need to make sure that it sinks so that you've got a nice sound weld. Easy peasy. It's one of those things, like, I don't need to try to focus so hard in trying to dip. Lay that sucker over and it's a sound weld. Now this part, having that bigger gap, You almost want that bigger wire. And that's just because I'm a shite fabricator. But a really good welder can make up for a really crappy fitter. You're just laying it in, letting it soak. We got a big gap there, but it's okay because we got enough thickness to deal with it. Like I said, if I'm having to work in a weird spot or around something, if I can just keep everything steady and not have to worry about dipping the wire in and just having enough amperage to let it soak, I might just lay wire it. It just makes for an easier day. But if I'm looking for a precise, really aesthetically pleasing weld, I'm gonna try to dip that old dog. Now there's also the situation you might find yourself in where you do both. You might do a little dipping and you might do a little bit of lay wire. Now there might be someone out there that can correct me and let me know down in the comments if there's a job out there that you do that requires you to specifically dab, dip, or lay wire, whatever you're working on to achieve the certain size weld that you're looking for. Most of the time I saw a lot of the dipping stuff and sheet metal and thinner materials and into plate, you start seeing that lay wire technique because you can start handling a lot more heat. But now we're seeing a lot of people on social media and like the refineries doing this dip technique even on their caps, which is fine, it's cool, because it doesn't matter as long as it x-rays fine. An x-ray doesn't show aesthetics. It only shows density, how thick things are. If it's the same thickness, it doesn't matter if you're dipping or you're lay wiring. That being said, we're gonna do a little bit of lay wire and a little bit of dip for the first pass and lay wire that second pass. If you guys wanna see some more techniques as far as dipping on the cap on a pipe or dipping on a root in a pipe, let me know.
Again, with any dip, you wanna wait and feed into that dip wherever you land. You gotta reposition. You can even pulse it a little bit if it helps you stay consistent. That's what I've always had to do. If I wanted to dip, not shut it all the way off, but pulse that foot pedal, because it helps me if I have to end up repositioning to get a different grip or my hand's burning or whatever it may be. I really like the manual pulse with my foot. That gives me the most control over a weld.
But it takes a lot of focus. That looks like the best one so far. Now you say you put that beauty of a stringer bead on there while you dip, but the code requires a little bit more weld and weld size. So we switch over to maybe a bigger wire, or we start feeding a little bit more, maybe we start walking the cup, doing different techniques. But even still, you're just gonna lay it on.
This is just, to me, it's a lot easier. There's not a lot of focus, not a lot of precision. I'm just laying that wire in the puddle and I'm moving my cup along. I don't have to worry about my hands burning up because I've got the torches pressing up against the steel and my hand is pressing up against the steel in a colder spot with my wire staying steady as I lay wire it.
These are some reasons why you might consider a lay wire. But it really depends on what you're welding on and what the code requires. If your foreman, your QC, and your project manager are sitting behind you watching you weld and you're just slinging whatever you want on there and they're giving you the thumbs up, then thumbs up, do whatever you want. But as soon as they come over and tell you how they need it to look, you be a good welder and put it on there how they want it to look. Well, y'all, I hope that helped answer someone's questions they may have on lay wire versus dipping. Again, I think it comes down to preference, what size weld you're trying to achieve, what kind of penetration you're trying to achieve, and what aesthetics you're trying to achieve, as well as if you're in a bind or not, if you just, one of those things where it doesn't have to look pretty, it just needs to get on there kind of thing. Just make sure your weld is clean and your weld is hot, and you should have no problems after that. That being said, guys, y'all be sure to check out all the links we got in our description. We'll see you all in the next weld. Get out of there.
1 second, please.
Did I hit record?
You know, sometimes I just don't know.
I can make so much nicer welds without that camera in my grill.